It's time for Supply Chain Now. Broadcasting live from the supply chain capital of the country, Atlanta, Georgia. Heard around the world, Supply Chain Now spotlights the best in all things supply chain. The people, the technologies, the best practices, and the critical issues of the day. And now, here are your hosts.
Hey, good afternoon. Scott Luton here with you on Supply Chain Now. Welcome back to the show. On today's episode, so as the economic effects of this crisis come into focus and the immediate risks to a supply chain have been identified, how can supply chain leaders begin preparing for not only the long term, but prepare to design a resilient supply chain for the future? We're going to be gaining insights on just that from an expert in the space. Stay tuned as we look to increase your supply chain leadership IQ. Quick programming note before we get started, if you enjoy today's conversation, be sure to find us and subscribe wherever you get your podcast from. All right, I want to welcome in my esteemed, fearless co-host for today's show, Greg White, serial supply chain tech entrepreneur and trusted advisor. Greg, how you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm really looking forward to this conversation. You know, we've had a conversation around automation and tools that are going to be necessary and how companies are recognizing what's going to be necessary coming out of this seismic societal disruption.
That's right. The new normal certainly ahead, and speaking for all of us, we can't wait to get there for sure. But you know, Greg, there's going to be a lot of assessing that did work, that didn't work in global supply chain in the weeks and months to come, right?
Undoubtedly. That's exactly what people are going to be assessing, and I think they're going to find pretty universally that if it was on paper, manually done or in a spreadsheet, it didn't work. We needed too quick of a response. We needed too sustainable of a response, and we needed the data to be captured and gathered to learn anything from it as times were changing so fast.
Well put. Well, we're going to get a head start on that conversation and that assessment in today's episode. So with no further ado, let's welcome in our featured guest here today, Daniel Reeve, Director of Business Development with Esker, a widely recognized leader in AI-driven process automation software all around the world. Dan, how you doing?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
You know, by understanding what's worked and what didn't work, you know, this is really the perfect time for businesses to focus on digital transformation by realizing the necessities that are accelerating it, right?
Sure. I mean, I think one of the things that's interesting is I think we all went through the shock and awe, and there was a period of a month there where many companies put everything on hold and took a breath. But what's interesting is in the last couple of weeks, last 3-4 weeks, we've had VPs of supply chain, CIOs come back or go ahead with projects. And I've been encouraging my staff to say, hey, go and ask, why are you doing this project now? Because many projects are being stalled or delayed. Why are you doing this? And we've had some recently, a chemical company came and said, look, we're doing this because in their case, they want to automate the capture of orders that come into their business. They get orders through a variety of methods, EDI, XML, paper, and PDFs. Mm-hmm. And they said, this is part of our digital transformation. We're doing a project because not only do we think it saves money and makes us more effective in front of the customer, we provide better customer experience, but actually, we want to prove we can still do digital projects, especially right now. It gives the organization a morale boost. This was just the start of the many things that we were going to do. They had a whole digital transformation plan. So I'm excited. As painful as it's been, and I'm sure it will be for a bit, I think it's really going to light up a lot of CIOs, supply chain leaders, business leaders to the idea of, well, actually, we can innovate here. And as Gartner say, don't waste a good crisis. I mean, I don't mean to be contrite when I say that, but clearly there's opportunity for us to get better at what we do.
Love that perspective. And we're going to dive into a lot more of what Dan Reeve has to say about automation, innovation, and digital transformation. But for starters, Dan, we want to back all the way up, and we want to make sure that folks get a chance to get to know you a little bit better. For starters, tell us a little more about yourself, you know, where you're from, and give us the goods on your upbringing a little bit there, Dan.
So I'm from Norwich, England, which is similar to Wisconsin, and I spent 5 years living in Wisconsin too. So it's flat, it's very much farm country, and I was just, you know, keen. I grew up, couldn't wait to join the military and get out of there. And you know, age 4, there was a point where I nearly ejected out of a fighter jet. My dad was working on the jet, and I was busy up in the cockpit trying to see what that yellow and black handle did, pulling at it, trying to get it to come loose. And the supply chain officer saw, actually the maintenance and supply chain officer saw what I was doing and yelled, "Get that kid out of that jet." So, you know, I was always a curious type of individual, good at breaking stuff and not putting it back together.
Wow.
An engineer at heart.
That's right. Absolutely. Well, let's switch gears a little bit. Now that we understand, you know, how to operate jet aircraft at age four, and let's talk more about your professional journey. Now, as we shared in the warm-up, you're a bit of an anomaly, if I can say that three times. You know, a lot of folks have had a variety of roles, but you've been with ESCR for over 20 years. So tell us more about that journey within the ESCR organization and some of the critical roles that have helped shape your worldview a bit.
Yeah, so I joined ESCR, and my intent was I wanted to join a company that would give me a good 5 or 6 years as a foundation in enterprise selling. And in the background, I still had my military reserve career for 12 years in both the British Army and the National Guard. They loaned me to the National Guard for a couple of years when I came to America. So I was predominantly working with clients who were running systems like Oracle, SAP, and nowadays any ERP. And what was going on is, first I worked in, they let me loose in Holland and Scandinavia and were paying for me to go over there. That was fun. And then I was selling all across Europe and the UK. And then the latter two-thirds of my career, I wanted to go and work in Sydney. They gave me Madison, Wisconsin. But that was okay. You know, I became a Packer fan. I met my wife in a corn maze. Life was good. So, but we were predominantly providing solutions to supply chain leaders and CIOs. Mm. You know, I like to say, people say, well, what do you guys do? And I like to say, well, we free up customer service reps, finance and accounts payable reps, and credit collection reps to go and be rock stars. We free up their time so they can provide more value to suppliers and customers and the supply chain and the finance operation, basically.
So that's a really interesting perspective, because what we're going to see is more and more companies doing more and more automation of so many of these jobs, and I think elevating the current human capital that's performing these jobs to higher meaningful, less menial type jobs, and allowed, I think, the type of solutions that you all deliver to tackle some of that repetitive type work. So, you know, as we think about what ESCR does and how it can help companies solve certain problems, I love to ask this question, and that is, I would say in my office, Dan, but nobody's in their office right now, but if I'm at my home or I'm walking down the hall and I've got a pain or I've got some keywords going through my head, what are those keywords that would have me, a leader, a decision maker, say, I think ESCR is who I need to talk to?
One of the keys, I think, the pains that many companies have suddenly had forced upon them is treasurers and CFOs are thinking, is my runway long enough? Can I land this organization on the other side of this gap that's come up? We've got to make sure we're getting our cash flow in. We can't necessarily suddenly increase or maybe even maintain revenue at what we were getting. We can make sure that we, you know, go and collect our money in a timely fashion. We know which companies might pay a little bit slower, because if they're predominantly serving the restaurant industry, could they be at risk? So there's kind of some elements of us, of what we do there on our receivable side of the business, order to cash. If folks are trying to, if they're looking at it saying, oh, I've got a load of customer service reps, well, are they really adding value by punching in orders?
Right.
You know, are they differentiating themselves right now? And here's one of the things we really are seeing. We may have furloughed some of our temporary staff that were responsible for processing orders. What's going to happen when things do pick up a little bit and we start getting more volume? Suddenly, we're going to be working harder, but our SLAs might not be where they should be. A classic one for the CFO is, hey, we buy stuff. I can't see what people are buying, especially now that people are all at home. They're buying things. I don't know what they're buying. And if we are buying, we should pay them quickly, because I'd like to know, can I negotiate, maybe move all those contracts and get better spend management? Or I'd at least like to know, is there an opportunity to get paid earlier? Because those suppliers, some of those would take an early payment discount if we paid them quicker. Maybe I'd like to know have a better insight as to, do I want to take advantage of that or not?
And that's a difficult navigation to do without all of the data available, right? And I think we often as human beings miss that because we're doing our day job. You know, so many times I'm responsible for X and you're responsible for Y, and we never cross paths to collaborate on something like that or cross pollinate. Right. So tell us a little bit about what you do there at Esker. What is your role and how do you spend your day, or how do you spend your days when you're working?
Well, you know, when I don't have my feet up and drinking a cup of tea and enjoying a biscuit, you know, the reality is I look after the field sales team. I've got about 30 folks and a couple of great managers that lead those teams. So my job really is to try and support those folks. And a lot of it is, it's not just selling and pushing a product. I mean, I think we're always trying to understand what is the value for the customer? What are they trying to do? How does this tap into the big picture? Because that allows me to say, okay, well, can other industries benefit from this? Can we improve and add this to our roadmap? So I believe, you know, predominantly I'm a sales guy. I lead the field sales organization. But I do believe I have a dotted line to product management to say, okay, this is what the market is asking for. The VP supply chain is trying to compete or trying to get through service. The VP supply chain CIO are trying to bring new people on board and give them tools so these people will actually stay within customer service or supply chain. The job is a bit more interesting because the technology isn't boring and ugly and they don't want to use it. So my job is to sort of convey that message back to Esker. Because yes, it probably leads to more sales, but also helps us develop and evolve.
Yeah, you know, had a few technology companies myself, and one thing I've seen is that the sales reps are on the front line, and you have to translate so often what we're saying in the marketplace into what we're actually delivering on the desktop or in the browser, right? And the sales reps see and hear that firsthand because they get the, no, we're not going to go with it because we thought it did this, or yes, we want it and we'd also like it to do that. In order to expand your business with us.
A lot of good stuff. And we're going to shift gears here and dive more into your thought leadership and your insights around three key phases here, Dan. The pre-pandemic, right? The current state. And then what we're all looking forward to getting into as soon as we can, the post-pandemic, or as Gartner's referring to, the aftermath. So let's dive into the first one first. So up first, what were some of the automation trends that you were seeing prior to the COVID-19 environment, Dan?
So I think CIOs, supply chain leaders, were keen to improve the omnichannel experience. They were looking, and if I dumb this down a little bit, you know, I told you I was a farm boy from Norfolk, England, so I've got to, you know, speak in as best I can. I think what we saw is they were saying, okay, well, I want to get orders in quickly, efficiently, work out if it's a change, make it easy for the customer, and compete through service. That was going on. Companies were looking to do perfect order or get as close to the perfect order as they could. They were looking to compete through, in fact, some of our customers have told us they were doing this, is they were, hey, we can detect rush orders, or we can detect that an order needs to get to a certain, or go through a certain DC, or there's a cutoff approaching. We can dynamically detect all that stuff before an order's even been fed into the ERP system. Or we can detect that order that's not been touched yet, that there's key items or products, or before somebody's even got to it, feed that into our supply chain. So even though we haven't fulfilled the order, we can sniff, we've got a sense of what's needed. And I think that, you know, what's interesting is some of the CIOs that I worked with here in Denver before were saying, man, it's tough. We're actually having to go and hire recruiting organizations to help us find supply chain staff and even customer service staff, because the economy's doing so well, we can't find those folks. I hear that a lot of folks have been furloughed or might get let go, and now it's like, okay, well, people are still going to have to do that work, because often you get the same number of orders, but maybe you don't get the same number of lines or the price that you were hoping. So I think things are probably going to change, but there are some companies out there saying, well, we think we'll still have growth, or we'll get back to similar where we were. We can't just go out and suddenly hire loads of people. That's just not going to work.
You know, that's not a dissimilar story to what we saw during the Great Recession, right around 2008 or so. You made me think, Dan, one of my neighbors owns a big plumbing supply distributorship, and they lost a chunk of business, of course, because the housing market was hit very hard, but then they gained it all back. But they weren't able to gain all of their staff back. So they wound up doing more orders with smaller customers, you know, and their customer mix changed as well. More orders with smaller customers with fewer people for the same amount of volume as they were doing before. And it was straining on their staff, to say the least. So I can see where, as the work dynamic changes, and it will change for the next several years, right? As the work dynamic changes, people will be constantly evolving how they approach various processes within their company.
I think this was going on anyway. I think what this exercise that we've got, I mean, this process we're going through right now, unfortunately, it's turning a flashlight, a torch, into processes and parts of the organization and exposing them. I mean, even, for example, on the finance side, you know, you still got to pay invoices, you still got to pay checks to suppliers. I know for a fact many of our customers have said, nobody wants to go in the office and pick up that paper. And I know that my controller says, I don't like to do it, Dan, but I've got to do it. But then that's fueling us, even as an organization, we've said, right, you know what? After this, my COO has said, contractually, when we sign up with suppliers, we'll say to them, you have to let us pay you electronically. Or you have to send us your invoices to us will have to be sent to us electronically. Because we don't want to be, if we do have a similar situation like this, or if we have to lock down again, but we can't be doing this again. And I think that's probably sentiment that will apply to many companies and many business processes once we, you know, I think you already see them starting to think about that now.
Well, so you kind of rolled right into how things were. I think you're, and I agree with you, by the way, Dan, that a lot of these evaluations were underway, and this pandemic and societal disruption was a catalyst for making some changes that were coming anyway. I'm interested because you guys are seeing it every day still, right? What are some of the risks or performance concerns or even excesses that you're seeing being exposed in the midst of this pandemic?
If I go back to the supply chain side, I think what I've seen is some of our customers have said to us, hey, we've changed the SLA, we've lowered our SLA that we can offer customers, or we've said to customers, we're not going to take any RMA requests right now because we need to focus on certain core areas, and that's just how we're going to have to operate for a little bit of time. Now, I think, you know, this does make me think a bit about another side of our business is supplier information management. There was talk before this event, and now I think this is getting ramped up. One of the things that the finance department and procurement often bicker over is, well, who's going to onboard new suppliers? Who's going to make sure that they're not a risk to our business, they've been through training, they're insured, they've got the right bank accounts? I was listening to a webcast yesterday, and they were talking about the risk and the likelihood of fraud is increasing, and maybe, you know, some employees will be in a difficult situation. Perhaps the partner's been laid off or furloughed. There may be a chance that it's more likely to happen. What we've seen is a lot of it was going on before. It seems to picked up in the last 5 weeks for us. Is a lot of companies saying, okay, I want an easy mechanism where we can vet and onboard suppliers faster, because you know what, we may have one or two small or really important strategic suppliers, but we might not be able to rely on those folks only. Or what if they go pop? Then what? That's a big risk to our supply chain. So what I've been hearing is a lot of companies saying, suddenly we need to onboard more suppliers to have more to spread our risk. But we cannot rely on the prior processes where it could take 30 days and four different requests for the supplier, the procurement, finance, and everybody else to finally get a supplier over the line. That has to accelerate now, both because we might be trying to look for new opportunities to save money when we buy goods and services, but I think we see a lot of it is we want to lower our risk for a variety of reasons, and having more suppliers might help do that.
It's been a topic of some significant discussion that companies should diversify their sourcing, right? Meaning, I've heard all sorts of terms, but the one that sticks in my mind is China plus one, or China plus two or whatever, but whatever that is, the necessity to mitigate that risk through multiple sourcing channels is one. But it does, as you said, in addition to the other economic conditions that your workforce might be going through, that opens you up to quality and fiscal and fraud risk as well, having a more diverse supplier platform. All right, so coming out of this, and we all hope we're coming out of this soon, right? As you look forward, what is a primary bit of advice you would offer for helping companies strengthen their capabilities with automation, with process or whatever to prepare for what's inevitable in terms of the next shock or disruption to the workplace?
You know, that's an interesting point, because whether it's COVID or other things, I do think similarly, I used this exercise to write a couple of blogs, and it was a great excuse to go back and talk to a lot of CFOs, CIOs that we work with, and reconnect with them. And there was a point there, you know, someone said, I've actually enjoyed the conversation, Dan, because I'm getting millions of emails more than I ever do, and everybody's at home just sending emails. But I did come away with this appreciation that many CIOs are looking at this saying, this or something else could happen again, and probably will. I think most, you know, I've seen some studies that 60% of CIOs expect something like this to happen again in the short or medium term. So I think certainly enabling, there was a point in the past where customer service folks could do order acquisition, do order entry from home, perhaps as a perk. Mm-hmm. Well, I think you're going to see, and we've probably all read many of the reports that talk about after this, employees will perhaps either expect Or you as an organization might want to have shifts where you allow some of your teams to work from home a few days a week. I could even see companies saying, you know what, every August, like our European colleagues, and I say that with tongue in cheek because I work for a French company, every August we'll work from home as a DR exercise. We'll test that we can do this. Or all back office staff, all those involved in order management, finance, receivables, and collections, we'll test this out. So I think that, once upon a time, the ability to work from home was a nice to have. Now it's going to be a mandatory, whether the employees demand it, expect it. Well, I think the business is going to look at it as sort of, hey, we need to prepare for this. And so if you're going to do that, well, you need technology, not just our technology, but you know, you can need various technologies to ensure you can get approvals, onboard vendors, process your orders, and identify any orders that need special instructions, or orders that need to go be routed through a certain DC because your normal DC is shut down, and recognize priority. I mean, one of the things is recognize priority SKUs. Some companies right now, I'll give you an example. So a very relevant example, you know, we're proud to be helping out Vyaire. Vyaire manufacture ventilators. So one of the things they're doing is their folks are working from home. And yes, they said, right, we need to prioritize, because we've got to get ventilators and ventilator parts. That's not all they do, but that's a key component of what they do. Well, we need to focus on sniffing any orders coming in, prioritizing those orders, getting those orders to the area of the country that need those things the most. Well, that's sort of, I think, what we learn, our ability to shift and pivot. Whether there's a pandemic going or not, I think people will be looking to take advantage of those abilities to move quickly on the fly in the future.
Yeah, I think that's going to be critical. We will likely not have a situation where the entirety of commerce is essentially shut down across the planet. But I think, and Dan, I'd love to get your feedback on this, I think we have been ignoring the risks, many of the risks that we have faced every day. And simply, as our friend Mike Griswold from Gartner says, we have been rewarding the arsonists rather than preventing the fires. We have been working really hard to overcome these sort of crises and disruptions, not nearly of this scale, that happen all the time, rather than really doing a risk assessment and creating a risk management process that helps to prevent or effectively recover from what may be a great multitude of these disruptions in the future.
If I could chime in here, Dan, I enjoyed your comments earlier about options for getting discounts if folks pay on time or early, and uncovering those options. Along those lines, when it comes to suppliers and vendors and what have you, if you could speak to two things that you're observing. First off, organizations not only checking on existing vendors, but really looking to onboard new vendors faster than ever. Speak to that need. And then I also want you to speak to, if you would, Dan, the incredible importance that exists and will certainly exist moving forward about making sure your strategic suppliers, your critical suppliers, not only keeping them, but ensuring that they're stable and they're healthy from a business standpoint. Speak to those two points, if you would.
I have to be honest here. I can only go so far. I'm not necessarily an expert here, but what I will say is what we see. I can base it on what we see. So definitely an uptick in folks showing interest in supplier information management in order to vet suppliers. And I think that isn't just, are those suppliers financially stable, you know, and you can do checks, or we could do checks based on, Dun & Bradstreet and others, but also, okay, are they, various other third-party solutions that sort of tell you, okay, well, geopolitically, are they in the right location? And I'm sure my friend, he's a head of sales over at Celestica. Mm-hmm. We've been talking. He said, yeah, there's been, you know, they're obviously one of the top three outsourced manufacturing companies in the world. And he said, look, you know, we're seeing tons of, even before this, and now it's accelerated, tons of folks saying, well, let's diversify our supply chain, look at nearshore, look at Mexico, or look at other plus two, as you were saying, mm-hmm. Other facilities in Asia. Let's do that. Let's work with Celestica to maybe create a new operation. On our end, what we're seeing is, what I think is going to happen, what we've been reading about, is companies moving their back-end process, like the shared service, and establishing a shared service maybe that's closer to home. And I think we may well see, possibly, maybe not immediately, you know, but we may see more jobs coming either closer to the US or even back to the US from a back-end perspective, i.e. the folks that receive the orders, process the orders, do some planning, chase the cash, etc. So I can't give you too much on that supply information management, other than I know that now not everybody's going to pay the suppliers early. I realize that.
Sure.
There's a liquidity crunch out there, folks. I think what we see is treasurers and CFOs want to know, whom are buying off? Can I save some money if I consolidate the spend? Mm. And can I see who's more likely to take an early payment discount? And should we, you know, do we want to take advantage of that or not? Mm. Maybe we want to sit on our cash, or maybe we want to pay them early, but pay them using a third-party provider of that money, not necessarily off our own books. So that's some of the stuff we see going on.
Clearly, based on the conversations and the blogs and the folks you're reaching out to, you've got your finger on the pulse of a lot of movers and shakers in industries. You know, a lot of senior, especially the CIOs, who are so involved in these digital transformations that have been taking place, and those that will be taking place, or those that will be picking up the pace to get more traction in the months ahead, right?
Yeah, I won't lie to you. Let's be honest, in the first 2 weeks, I decided to go and write some blogs, because what happened on our end is this. I had some large manufacturing companies, one of them here in Denver, who deployed our technology across the world and then said, oh, we're going to stall the project for the US. And I said, why is that? Is it a money thing? And they said, no, we don't know how to deploy technology and innovate if it will be successful at a time when everybody's suddenly working from home. And that prompted me to say, okay, I'm going to write a blog. I'm going to go and interview lots of CIOs and consultants, system integrators, and say, okay, well, how do we do this? I don't think we can just stop and lay down our tools and wait it out. I think we're still going to have to, you know, take some precautions and plan ahead. And so what I decided to do is that gave me an excuse to go and talk to lots of these customers we've worked with and say, okay, what do you think we should do? What's your ideas? You know, is it more training, more testing, deploy technology in smaller bite-sized chunks, more use of Zoom calls to make sure that you can see if people are struggling with the technology and if they buy in, business unit leaders to give their people more time to actually test. Because let's be honest, if you don't have a trainer stood right next to you, it can be a bit harder to understand technology. Yeah, I used it as an excuse. It was my savior for a week or two there, because I was like, well, what are we going to do? But what was interesting is this. I'll say this to anybody who oversees a sales function. It was easier to connect with customers than I think it's been at any point in the last 10 years, because I was able to pick up the phone and get through to CIOs and CFOs and some senior folks, because suddenly everyone's at home. And maybe they were, I think it was accurate. People were working a lot, 2 or 3 hours longer a night, but it was possible to pick up the phone and talk to people. And if there's ever any silver lining that has come through this exercise, for me, that was, I enjoyed the reconnection with people.
That's interesting that you say that, Dan, because I have a daughter who sells technology as well, and she has experienced exactly the same thing. And they're actually quite interested in talking because there's not a whole lot going on in some businesses as well. So interesting, I think, that some of the social dynamics that we're starting to see come to the fore. Hey, I have a question for you because what you said prompted me to think about a discussion we had earlier today when we were talking with Mike from Gartner, and that was around supply chain visibility. It seems like there's a stronger than ever need for supply chain visibility to understand what's going on in your supply chain and in and outside of your enterprise. Can you share with us a little bit about what you've heard or seen or expect to see around that?
Actually, I'll go back about a decade because it's a similar story, but with a different driver right now, I think. You know, if I go back 10 years ago, I did a project with Kimball Furniture. Many of us will have used their desks and chairs. And back then, what they said is, right, what we're trying to do is move from, I think they were number 5 or 4 in the market. We want to get to number 3. I said, how are you going to do that? Well, we're going to deliver product faster than anybody else. We're going to optimize warehouse, DCs, supply chain, and technology. And to use an expression that, you know, from the British Army, when an order came in, they wanted that order to get processed at the speed of 1,000 gazelles, i.e. really fast. So they wanted to compete through customer experience. They wanted the customer to go, wow, that was quick. You delivered faster than I expected. It was almost like they were thinking Jeff Bezos, Amazon-like before we got all used to buying everything off Amazon. So I think that's going to go on again now, which is now the companies want early detection of key SKUs and quantities, and they want to know if there's a problem with the order. Is this a change order? What's going on? I think people want advanced visibility of what's being ordered so they can quickly make decisions of, oh, well, I can't get it from that DC. Okay, we're going to have to ship it from here or talk to a different supplier. And I think, forget Esker for a minute, I think other vendors like this, I know Brock Johns at Gartner does a lot of research on supply chain management software. I mean, I think of people like Four Kites, I think is one of the good product out there. Not that we have any affiliation with them, but I think people talk well. I could imagine that people are going to look at not just what orders are coming in, but once we've got them, where are we going to get them? How long is it going to take? If any one of these pieces of the jigsaw puzzle gets upset, what's our impact? So yeah, I think our job is we can help give visibility of what's coming in. But then there's loads of stuff that happens after you've got that order. Then what happens in terms of manufacturing it, sourcing it? Are there any delays in shipping or, you know, what other factors I'm not even thinking about?
Gartner keeps coming up here, and we all know that the Gartner Top 25 Supply Chain Rankings are coming out in a few weeks. That'll be interesting, as always it is each year, as they look at some large global enterprise companies and what they're doing to move their supply chain organizations and the overall business forward. You know, along those lines, Dan, let's talk about some of your key observations related to current and ongoing Gartner research. So, you know, related to the global pandemic, what key takeaways from Gartner do you find the most important to consider for our audience?
Gartner have been talking, and many of us have been to the Gartner events in Arizona, will have heard Gartner say, innovate in the turns. And they've got, you can just Google this and find white papers out there that talk about how companies in the last downturn, even though I think only a fourth or one-fifth companies, they say, did this, would actually go and spend money in investments in technology and process improvement. They said, you know, there's going to be so much pressure on you to stop innovating, to pause that project. And their point was, if you followed a lot of the Fortune 500 companies that did make those investments, they all outperformed their peers over the following decade. You know, that's easy. You might say, oh, I can read that. That sounds great. But for me, what's been true story, I've literally had CIOs get in touch with us in the last few weeks, and I won't say who they are, but they've come and said, I want to innovate. I want to collect our money faster. I want to use this as an opportunity to beat the competition. And that's their words or what they wrote in an email. Because, you know, clearly I think they're keen on protecting their companies and taking care of their staff so they compete and they have jobs. And they realize, right, not only is this an opportunity, a sense probably all of us feel a need to innovate and improve and not keep operating as we did because, you know, we've all got families to take care of too. So I think many of the things that Gartner say I really appreciate because I'm actually, when I see it then with CIOs and CFOs coming back and saying, well, yeah, ultimately, we want to improve our day sales outstanding or our collections efficiency, or we want to outperform the competitors.
And you know, part of the silver lining of the dark cloud that has been the pandemic environment has been the uplifting stories, the innovation stories. You know, you're talking about the organization that makes ventilators earlier that y'all work with. To see automotive companies and other companies that don't make ventilators figure out how to do it so they can throw their weight behind the fight against COVID-19. Undoubtedly, while that's a meaningful, impactful, feel-good story today, it undoubtedly will lead to real innovation down the road that will make businesses smarter, brighter, more innovative, that ultimately all consumers will benefit from. So that's, you know, Greg, you and I have had that conversation 1,000 times in recent weeks, moving at the speed of 1,000 gazelles through those conversations. Despite these troubling times, companies are going to innovate to solve problems old and new, right?
Well, and we've seen so many companies who are doing exactly, Dan, what you said, and that is they're using this time to prove they can do it. So many of them are using this as a leverage point for their technology organizations to augment the tool sets that they've got or conduct a digital transformation. Technology companies are enhancing their tech. Maybe you all are too, because the slowed pace of everyday business actually allows the acceleration of the technology organizations to do what they do. They've got more access to the people with knowledge. And those are, you know, some of your salespeople, Dan, those are product management people. Those people are more accessible and they can catalyze some of the transformations that companies want to make in these technology areas. It's a really interesting dynamic.
Well, I agree. You know, I saw the 60 Minute TV show, was it 2 weeks ago, where they talked about what Ford was doing. And I thought it gave me a lift and it was inspiring. Right. And there was a moment there where I think the CEO said, oh, we've taken what we've learned here into a completely different area of how we do, I think, quality testing or how we operate as a company. And I have no doubt there'll be in the future, there'll be business schools will be teaching, okay, this came up. Everybody's racing to sort of innovate and supply ventilators or I look at even the companies that Pernod Ricard, I think it was, that suddenly said, you know what? We can make hand sanitizer. Alcohol is a core component of what we make normally. And, you know, okay, we can adjust. So I do think that's what's very interesting. It'll be interesting, you know, in 10 years time when we look back.
Yeah.
All right. One final question as it relates to digital transformation, because it seems like to me, hearing some of the things you've shared, some things directly and indirectly, and it seems like other third parties agree, many organizations are going to be, they've got all more the reason and ammunition and business case to push digital transformation even harder and faster and with more intent now. Is that accurate, Dan, from what you're saying?
I think so. I'm not going to say to everybody, oh, it should just be 10 times easier. I think companies are still going to have to look at it and say, okay, right, specifically, how much time do we save? How does this cut costs? If anything, having gone and being a sales guy in the last recession, I learned you had to help companies. Yes, there's somebody there that has an emotional reason they want to implement technology and change, but you really, in these times, have to be four times better at, well, okay, what's this going to save us? What's the business case? Where's the efficiency? Or how does it help us gain? But I think big picture, yes, what's going on now is everybody's aware of the need to improve and collect cash faster. Mm-hmm. Everybody's aware of the idea of digital transformation, and I see it as a bit like, you know, it's been cooked hotter. It's boiling on the stove. Now everybody in the organization, perhaps it was a buzzword. Now I think people are more like, okay, yeah, I get it. I've seen some situations where we didn't have that and it was problematic when we were all working from home. So yeah, I think for the supply chain and technology leaders out there who are interested in implementing technology, this probably allows them to bring the subject to the stakeholders or the steering committee. Clearly, they're still going to have to justify it and probably have to work even harder at it.
You've touched on two critical issues that will assure the success or enhance the opportunity for success in a difficult time like this, and the difficult time, the inevitable, at least short-term recession. Who knows how long the recession is, but in any time that a recession occurs, cash is critical, and the recognition that you need to be more efficient and effective is critical. And technology, you know, robotic process automation, AI, visibility and analytical tools, all of those things will help companies. And Dan, I'll share with you something we've been saying for some time, and that is if you have been foolish enough to build your house on sand, being your technology house, and you survive this situation, be wise enough to next time build it on stone so that you survive the next coming pandemic. And I, you know, that makes me think a lot about your, you know, one of the things you shared in the pre-show talk was fight, move, live. You know, when you're fighting in an urban environment, I think that's a really interesting concept. So can you share a little bit about that fight, move, live concept as we kind of move to close here?
Yeah. So, I mean, I was a combat engineer in the British Army, and you know, there's many different tasks that can throw at you, but the whole idea of I was in the Royal Engineers, and really the way they view themselves is our job is to help the army fight, so clear minefields, clear urban areas, move, and to live. And so sometimes that might mean, well, okay, we need to feed them and house them, a variety of things. I think for me, when I was in Iraq, I got really interested in supply chain from a certain point of view because I'd see things going on around me. When I first got off the jet and I landed in Kuwait, I felt like a can of beans because I got zapped. Somebody put a barcode scanner up to me and zapped me into theater. And I said, "What are you doing?" She's like, "I'm booking you in. I'm booking you. You know, you're an asset. You just got booked into a military theater, and we're showing everybody back at base in HQ command in the UK can see where you're at."
Wow.
You're not that important, son, but they can see where you are. You just got barcoded into theater, you know, and then I saw things like there was a supply chain issue that led to about 25 of these fighter jets that the Kuwaitis had, F5 fighter jets. They were all kind of, they were all sitting there, but they were in a, you know, you could tell that they couldn't fly them. There were bits missing. And I remember saying to a few folks, "Well, aren't those jets kind of expensive? Why are they sitting there?" "Well, they're missing a load of supply pieces, and they've been trying to get them into theater, but they're coming from France, and they're not here yet." So, you know, it got interesting all the way through to a final story I'll leave you with is we were in Abazra, and we didn't have much water. So he said, "Right, we're gonna ration. You know, you can only have one shower every 10 days, but you just use wet wipes." But then somebody put out a message on Facebook saying, this squadron, we don't have any wet wipes. We're dirty. We haven't even got enough water to drink." It wasn't quite true, but the media in the UK took this. And suddenly the whole of the British Isles was concerned that my squadron was thirsty and dirty. 15 vehicles carrying wet wipes arrived to drop off. So, you know, there wasn't much true authentication of the demand, but this signal got sent back to the UK that these guys need this supply and they need it right now. Ironically, the company that makes those wet wipes is now one of our customers. And I tell, you know, I joke with them, I'm like, "Well, you guys must have made some money because when 15 vehicles turned up,
yeah,
you know, and there's more wet wipes than I can point a stick at." It was kind of funny. We didn't know where to put these vehicles, let alone all the wet wipes.
Solving one problem creates others. But hey, blessed be the ties that bind and folks that jump in there with action to meet a need. But that, what a great story. And I bet, Dan, I bet you could write a book about some of those experiences. And I love how you view things, Greg, through the supply chain lens. You know, that's,
well,
you're looking back, right?
Well, and I think that's a really valuable analogy, frankly. I mean, regardless of whether in this case, it fortunately tied right into supply chain, right? But regardless, that fight, move, live that's a simple way to approach what we're dealing with right now. And I think companies would do well to have very simple mantras like that at a time like this. So thank you for that. That was a great story. And you're right, Scott. It's a great insight into how things are being approached today and how so many of these stories, and we see this all the time, Dan, how many of these stories can be related into supply chain. So not to go into great detail, but the chief supply chain officer at Coca-Cola relayed a very similar story about supply chain efficiency and his paper route, mostly having to do with his ability to get back to bed at 5:30 in the morning. So he was motivated to efficiency. So Dan, thank you for your time. Tell our listeners, this is the most difficult question you're going to face today. Tell our listeners how they can connect more with you and with Esker.
Predominantly just hit our website, www.esker.com. Hit me on, reach out to me, and we can have a chat on LinkedIn, Daniel Reeve at Esker. No S, I'm not that famous. Everybody here in Denver thinks I might be Dan Reeves' son or something like that, but I'm not. That's
oh
not me.
My gosh, I didn't even think about that. I did not tie that.
Well, I often have to bite my tongue at that point because I have to remind folks that, you know, I like to look out for the Broncos, but I'm a Packers fan. I married a girl from Wisconsin. It was part of the rules. And they would sell me if I didn't support the Packers. So, yeah, by all means, hit Esco. We do have quite a lot of ongoing, obviously now, virtual events and webcasts and customer-led panel discussions. So feel free to, you know, hit me up on LinkedIn.
Outstanding. And that's esker.com, E-S-K-E-R.com. I lost myself into a couple hours and all the resources that are on their website. So, and as Dan mentioned, not Coach Dan Reeve, but Daniel Reeve with Esker. You can check him out on LinkedIn. Dan, I am so glad we got connected. I feel like there's so much more to your story that we'll have to cover in future episodes. Really enjoyed it. All the best to you and your family and the rest of the Esker organization.
Yeah, it was a pleasure. Really enjoyed it, guys. And maybe one of these days when we're allowed to travel, we'll grab a beer with you. So thanks very much. I enjoyed it.
Definitely. I want to find out more about the ejection seat story. I feel like there's a lot.
I know. There's more there, isn't there?
Good stuff. So big thanks to our guest today, Daniel Reeve, Director of Business Development with Esker. Greg, some really good stuff there, right?
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. I mean, look, there is so much to learn. And I think the thing that Dan pointed out and that we hear frequently is that companies are actively and intentionally learning throughout this process, and they're applying it immediately. Necessity is the mother of invention, and what could be more necessary than to survive this situation? It's just another example of, you know, what I think we all believe, and that is fight, move, live, right?
So, absolutely. One of my new favorite sayings.
Yeah, I'm telling you, I'm going to co-opt that one.
Speed of 1,000 gazelles. Two great t-shirts, we'll have to owe Dan some exclusive copyrights there or something. But good stuff. Greg, thanks for your time today. What a great day, great week, great interview here as we sat down with Daniel Reeve, once again, Director of Business Development with Esker, and you can learn more at esker.com. All right, so to our audience, I hope you enjoyed the conversation as much as we did. Be sure to check out a wide variety of industry thought leadership at supplychainnowradio.com. Find us and subscribe wherever you get your podcast from. On behalf of our entire team, Scott Luton here wishing you a successful week ahead. Stay safe. Know this, brighter days certainly lie ahead, and we'll see you next time here on Supply Chain Now. Thanks, everybody.